When it comes to studying or working at a prestigious institution, many tend to search for the 3 top tips or 50 templates to success. But when you listen to podcasts or interviews, those who have worked for a while will surely tell you stories about how their careers come to be. I've started telling you about why I wanted to work at Harvard Kennedy School of Government in my last video. Now, I'm going to explain what the project was and the amazing twists and turns. The nonprofit organization was called Global Action for Health. Its CEO, Michelle Lydon, was a registered nurse from Boston who joined the Clinton Health Access Initiative, CHAI, in the early 2000s. She had extensive experience in pediatric HIV/AIDS, but when she worked in Rwanda, she realized that with all the good intentions of vaccinations and medicines from Big Pharma, infants and children are still dying from mother-to-child transmission of HIV. After a couple of years, she got into the Harvard Kennedy School to do her master's in international relations. And her mentor happened to be the world-renowned expert on African policy affairs, Professor Robert Rotberg. The underlying issue that affected the treatment of diseases in Africa, Michelle found, was severe chronic malnutrition. Without proper nutrition, the immune system gets weak. An injection of an HIV vaccine that aims to elicit an immune response when children are already vulnerable may be fatal. Michelle wanted to incorporate malnutrition along with AIDS treatment. Now, Professor Rotberg knows sub-Saharan Africa really well. So with him as an advisor, Michelle founded global action and focused in Tanzania, particularly the villages in Lindi and Mtwara. How did Heinz come into play? Yep, the Heinz that make ketchup among various food products. Turns out, it has a very successful micronutrient campaign. It's got the money and has just joined the Clinton Global Initiative the year before. Their research arm worked on food fortification based on clinical evidence and efficacy studies of micronutrients, and came up with a solution called sprinkles. They are sachets with vitamins and minerals, easy for children to swallow, and not intimidating like a pill. In rural villages in Africa, there's no need to wait for healthcare professionals to prescribe or administer. Sprinkles have been used in places like Bangladesh. And if you remember the deadly earthquake and tsunami that hit Indonesia in 2004, sprinkles have been used as an emergency supplement as well. After my time at Global Action, Heinz rolled out the micronutrient campaign in Tanzania.
In Tanzania, natural beauty and hope lie against a backdrop of dire poverty and disease. Home to 41 million people, this African nation enjoys political stability and a growing economy, but 40% of its people survive on less than $1 per day. Sadly, 6 in 10 children under age 5 suffer iron deficiency and anemia, limiting their ability to reach their full human potential. But there's hope on the horizon. The Heinz Micronutrient Campaign entered Africa with a new program to address vitamin and mineral deficiency in 4 villages in rural Tanzania. Through a unique partnership with the Sokoine University of Agriculture and Michigan State University, the campaign is making Heinz NurtureMate micronutrient powders available to children whose daily diets lack essential nutrients. The campaign is making a profound difference in the lives of Tanzanian families and children. At the Kichigani Village Health Clinic, a crowd of mothers, traveling as far as 5 kilometers on foot with their children in tow, waited patiently in the sticky midday heat. One by one, the children were measured and weighed. They moved to another room where a technician pricks their fingers to administer a blood test, which confirmed the expected. Nearly 90% of the children suffer from iron deficiency. The mothers each receive sachets of NurtureMate to mix into their children's normal food over the next 3 months. When tested again after consuming NurtureMate, every child's blood level has been restored to normal.
They even have Lucy Liu as their ambassador.
It's wonderful. It's very simple. You open up the package, you sprinkle a little food. There's no taste, there's no odor, and kids eat their food not knowing what it is, and they're getting all the things that they need to be healthy. And children under 5 are especially vulnerable to having this iron deficiency anemia.
Well then, what does Global Action need me for? Professor Rothberg thought that I could be the lead in business development and raise funds. Global Action was a bit stuck with the Clinton Global Initiative because CGI operate on something called commitment to action. They don't directly give out X amount of US dollars every year. The Heinz Sprinkles was also what's called donations in kind. These are great, but you can't pay people's wages or buy a flight ticket to Tanzania with sachets of vitamins. I thought, asking people for money is straightforward. Maybe I could bolster existing partnerships, diversify their donation sources, and build a sustainable machine that attracts donors to want to put money in. So for CGI, each NGO had to fill in a form like this. Then, CGI will have a network of 2,000-3,000 organizations ready to share expertise in management, technology, manufacturing, etc. Procter & Gamble already showed interest because you can't tackle malnutrition without safe drinking water and proper sanitation. P&G was also one of my clients when I was a consultant in the UK, so I found connections there. Tanzania has a high burden of tuberculosis HIV co-infection, and when I was a summer student at Oxford, I've worked on a drug target for anti-tuberculosis therapy. So I used that link to write to tuberculosis funding bodies. You can really see that I'm giving my all here, because going further back to my undergraduate years, I did parasitology in my final year and learned a great deal about mosquitoes. In Tanzania, malaria is responsible for over a third of deaths among children under five. So there are charities like the United Nations Foundation that provide bed nets to African countries. Little did I know, 3 years after Global Action, I'd be a fundraiser for major projects for the University of Oxford. And 10 years after this, I would help launch the HIV two-drug regimens in the pharmaceutical industry. What I'm trying to say is, there's no set formula. Like, when I needed somewhere to stay while working for Global Action, I encountered another surprise. I found a 70-year-old lady on the Harvard housing website renting out a room. Nancy was one of the pioneering women who went to Radcliffe College when it was a female counterpart for the all-male Harvard College. She's an editor in Historic New England. She was so taken by my reasons for going to Boston that she didn't even ask for a deposit. She told me to just hop on a bus from Logan Airport to Harvard Square, and her house would be within walking distance.
Young lady. Ladies.
In hindsight, we should be more cautious of each other. But I was young, and Nancy said she was too old to care. If you walk past Harvard Coop and T-Mobile, which magically survived after all these years, there's a cemetery. Seems like I was just following my muscle memory. I remember this church, but can't recall the Sheraton Hotel being there. Here's Christ Church, which reminded me of my college. Before this junction, there's Longji School of Music, where I got to watch many free music recitals. Nancy's place, when I got to my bedroom, the walls were covered in these amazing drawings and photographs. Wen Fei did all that. She's the girl you're subletting from, Nancy said. She's a PhD student at Harvard, but spending the summer teaching evolutionary biology at Oxford. So, we basically swapped places without knowing. How insane was that? I emailed Wen Fei during the COVID lockdown after I read her two books published during the pandemic. She's just so talented, so humble. To this day, I can't believe how lucky I was, doing meaningful work, living in this beautiful, leafy neighborhood filled with history. It's good to see some of my usual hangout spots still standing. Sadly, this shopping center where I saw John Malkovich suffered. A very famous Chinese restaurant, Yanjing, at the corner of Mass Ave and Holyoke Street is now the vegetarian Clover Food Lab. I mean, what even is this? I didn't have to suffer the lack of food choices at Harvard Square, because I wasn't told until a few days before I started that my office was not at the Kennedy School, but in Back Bay. Every morning when I went to work, this was the view. I'd get some breakfast from Dunkin' Donuts and head up to the fancy building at 131 Dartmouth Street to an office in the law firm Dion and Gas, because office space can also be a donation in kind. I know, I should have taken this cue to do law much, much earlier, but we just had a fun time eating sushi at Dozo downstairs. I went there this time and, strangely, they've covered up all the prices. This rather regular sushi set and a beer now cost over $65 with tips. Ugh. The commercial vibe at Back Bay, Prudential Center, and the Newbury Street area was a huge contrast to the student-y atmosphere around MIT and Harvard. I did buy a whole suitcase full of shoes, but I also joined the Barack Obama presidential campaign in Back Bay. It was my first introduction to the political world. It was eye-opening to freely discuss different views, what people care most about, and even make fun of each other. I knocked on professors' doors at the Kennedy School, so thankful that they took the time to meet with me. From our casual attire and my rather bushy eyebrows, I wasn't lying when I said in my MIT video that everyone at Harvard was on a summer holiday mood. When I knew about the CGI Asia meeting in Hong Kong, I obviously became part of the team, excited and feeling equipped, ready to serve. Well, we all know what happened in the last quarter of 2008, the financial crisis. The talks of charitable causes, philanthropy, all went out the window. And in 2016, the Clinton Foundation was under attack and they shut it down. Life is unexpected like that. Most guides or influencers will tell you to keep doing more and more. But I hope these examples will show you what patience can bring. And of course, notice and appreciate the miracles along the way.